Hey Bowtie Nation, Joseph Hogue here, and I want to start today's video with something different, a question for you. What is the longest you've held a stock, and how long have you held the stocks in your portfolio? Because if you're like most investors, it's not very long. Data from the New York Stock Exchange shows the average holding period for stocks is now just 5.5 months. Investors are holding stocks for less than half a year on average. That's down from an average holding period of 8 years back in the 50s. In fact, this graphic from Visual Capitalist shows the stock holding periods have been falling steadily since the 1960s, breaking down to under a year just in the last 20 years. And you know what? There's nothing wrong with that. I like to trade in and out of stocks just as much as anyone, trying to find that next big thing. But wouldn't it be nice to have at least some of your stocks that you never have to worry about? What if you could put part of your portfolio in just a handful of stocks that boom or bust would make you money over the next 10 or 20 years? In this video, I'll reveal the 11 best stocks to buy and hold forever, one best of breed stock from each sector that you can buy now and know that your portfolio is going to grow. I'll show you how I picked each of these and what to look for in that forever stock. We're getting started, but before we do, you know I've got to send that special shout out to all you out there in the nation. Thank you for spending a part of your day to be here. If you're not part of that community yet, just click that little red subscribe button. It's free and you'll never miss an episode. Now, most forever stock videos focus exclusively on those growth stocks, those hot stocks from just a few sectors like technology and the internet. And this one is going to be different though, to give you that diversified portfolio of stocks that will not only grow long term, but also protect you from a crash in any particular group. I'm going to reveal one buy and hold stock to buy from each sector of the economy. Let's start with consumer staples and Estee Lauder, ticker EL, the second largest by market share in the global premium beauty market. Estee controls 13.2% of the market, closely behind L'Oreal with 16%, and nearly twice as much as its next largest competitor, LVMH, with just 7% of the market. Estee Lauder has some of the most recognizable brands in the category, with a number one or number two market spot in 40 countries. Now, that gives it strong pricing power for higher profitability, and premium makeup isn't affected quite as much by off-brands or inflation as we see in a lot of those other consumer goods. Now, customers are paying for that quality and the brand. They aren't likely to switch just because of the price. Sales growth is up 5.6% annually over the last 3 years, but accelerating up 9.9% in the most recent quarter. Now we really see that premium pricing come through in the profitability though, with a 20.4% operating margin, well above its peers and increasing 4% over the last 3 years on that cost savings program. Again, I'll explain why I'm looking at these measures to find our forever stocks later in the video, so keep watching for that. And more than a quarter of its sales are now from that e-commerce channel, and I think there's a lot of untapped growth here as that live online shopping becomes more popular in social media. This is one of the biggest trends in China, and businesses are trying to bring that to the US. And the idea here is custom made for the beauty industry. That combined with strong opportunity in the emerging markets where Estee is building out leadership in China, India, and Brazil, gives the stock some good long-term catalysts. Shares are now trading for just 5.1 times on a price-to-sales basis, which is right around that 5-year average, but well below the 8x multiple we saw last year. It's also well off its 5-year price-to-earnings valuation, so some good value here along with that long-term potential. For the real estate sector, I really like the growth potential in gaming and leisure properties, ticker GLPI, along with its 6% dividend yield. The company owns 52 properties in 17 states, many without a competitor for more than 60 miles. Its casinos are operated by some of the biggest names like Caesars, Boyd, and Penn National, with gaming and over 15,000 hotel rooms. Now, besides the growth in gambling that we're just starting to see across the US, I really like the company's strategy here. It contracts with these operators on a triple net basis, which means the casinos pay all the costs, including maintenance, and GLPI has been able to keep 100% occupancy since inception. Now, obviously, this is one of the property types that really got hit during the pandemic, but free cash flow is already on its way higher. GLPI booked $1.2 billion in sales last year, a record for the company, and 6% above pre-pandemic revenue. Now, the company also generated $728 million in free cash flow over the last year, nearly double the $424 million in 2020 free cash flow, and above pre-pandemic as well. Now, this is not a value stock at just over 9x on that price-to-sales basis and 21x price-to-earnings, but this is a company producing a 67% operating margin, which is very high even for real estate stocks. that long-term growth is there, along with some near-term catalysts and a return to gaming. In communication services, Walt Disney, ticker DIS, is the perfect example of a media empire done right. Now, we've seen a lot of other companies try to tack together some kind of content and distribution from AT&T to Paramount and now Warner Brothers, but only Disney has been able to unlock the secret. Between the theme parks, media distribution with Disney Plus and Hulu, studio content with Marvel, Lucasfilm, Pixar, and 20th Century Fox, and its cable distribution with ABC, ESPN, and FX, Disney just has that synergy of content and distribution that no one has been able to perfect. The company was able to reach 130 million subscribers on streaming 3 years ahead of schedule. It took Netflix more than a decade to reach that, and Disney is now estimating as many as 260 million plus subscribers by 2024. And where I think Disney has that competitive advantage over those other streaming providers is because of that studio business and the other content. You see, one of the biggest worries I have about streaming stocks right now is it is getting ridiculously expensive to produce all that content, all those movies and shows. We're seeing it come through in that lower profitability on Discovery, Paramount, even Netflix. But with Disney, with the movie and the cable studios, it's able to continuously pump out those new shows that people want to see. Revenue is now back to pre-pandemic highs and was up 23% year over year last quarter on that jump in theme park attendance. You've got streaming still doing well, the return of the theme parks, and it still has the studio box office revenue growth to look forward to when that gets back to normal. Now, the one weakness here is that profitability. You know, spending has increased significantly on content and streaming, and of course the pandemic hit profitability, but it's now starting to turn around. The operating margin of 5.5% last year is already back up to 8.3% in the most recent quarter and should continue to improve this year. Shares of Disney have come way down over the last year, crashing 42% from the peak and now trade for just 2.6 times sales. That's the lowest since 2012 and a 25% discount to the 5-year average. And this is all happening as those theme park sales continue to improve and the company becomes a cash flow machine. And we'll get back to that list, but all you out there in the nation know, I'm not just about to drop a list of stocks in your lap and say, go at it. I want you to understand what I'm looking for here so you can make your own decisions, do your own research, and just find the best stocks for your portfolio. And with this, I started with a top-down approach to investing, looking for the industries with growth that can carry all the stocks in that group higher over the next 10 years. Because even the best of the best horse buggy maker went out of business when Ford made his cars affordable to everyone. So for these long-term stocks, I want to find the growing industries that are going to do more than just survive over the next 10 or 20 years. And for that, I looked at industry growth rates and data from the Stern School of Business at NYU. There are some great data sets available here for stock research, and I'm looking for industries with strong revenue growth over the past 5 years, but also ones with good expected earnings and revenue growth in the future. So I can sort these and see what we've got with some strong industries here like biotech and pharmaceuticals, software, and entertainment. And that gave me a list of industries to focus on within those major sectors. It helped me narrow down where I want to look for those best stocks to buy and hold. Now, looking at all the stocks in those growth industries, I started looking for companies with a competitive advantage over their peers. For this, I looked for sales growth higher than the industry average over the last few years for an idea of which companies are able to take that market share away from competitors. So that higher sales growth, it not only generally means higher profits and stock returns, but it's a great indicator of a moat for a company that it's doing something right compared to its competitors. And finding the sales growth for a company is fairly easy. You can go here to Yahoo Finance and click on the statistics tab for a lot of great information. Scroll down a little and you'll find the revenue growth for the most recent quarter. Here we see it's 23% for Disney over the last year. Now, ideally, we would want a longer term measure of growth, so we can go back up here to the financials tab to see the company's income statement. Now, this always starts with the total revenue, and we see Disney reported sales of $67.4 billion last year. If we take that divided by the 2018 number reported here of $59.4 billion, we see Disney has grown its sales by 13.4% over the past 4 years. Of course, now we would just want to compare that against the sales growth of competitors in the industry to see who might have that competitive advantage leading to that faster sales growth. I recently did a video on how to do just that, how to find competitors in an industry and compare the stocks side by side. So I'll link to that video in the description below. Check that out. Finally here, before we get back to that list of stocks to buy, I'm looking for companies with a higher operating margin versus others in its industry. Now, those of you in the nation know the operating margin is my favorite measure of a company performance, that operating income divided by sales. It's how much of revenue is left over after paying all the operating and production costs. It really shows how efficient management is at turning sales into profits. Now, finding the operating margin is also pretty easy. Again, we can go to the statistics tab here on Yahoo and scroll down to find that operating margin and the profit margin. Again, though, it's best to double check this in the financial statement, and it's going to give you another measure of the stock. To get that operating margin, we just take the operating income divided by the total revenue for that year. Here we see Estee Lauder booked just over $3 billion in operating income against $16.2 billion in sales for a margin of 18.5% last year. Now, you can compare that against competitors to see who is the most profitable, but I also like comparing it against the company's own history to see if it's getting more or less profitable. If we do that for Estee Lauder here, with operating income of $2.28 billion and sales of $13.6 billion in 2018, we get an operating margin of 16.6%, which means not only is this company growing its sales, but it's getting more profitable at the same time. In the materials sector, Air Products, ticker APD, isn't a company you hear about much, but this $54 billion chemical and gas company is essential to industrial activity. APD owns over 1,800 miles of gas pipeline, serves over 170,000 customers in bulk and packaged gases, and has business in 50 countries. APD has long-term contracts with many of its customers because those industrial gases it supplies are so critical to production that its customers want to lock in that supply. That means customer switching is pretty much non-existent, and APD has a global scale that no other company can match in its industry. Shares are down 23% from the recent high just on that overall market weakness, but management actually reaffirmed its full-year earnings outlook. And while most companies are lowering their 2022 guidance, sales were up 18% for APD in the second quarter, and full-year sales are expected 17% higher to $12.1 billion. After the sell-off, shares are down to 4.8 times on that price-to-sales ratio, the lowest valuation since 2018, and a 10% discount to its five-year average. It's not as cheap as some of the growth stocks on the list, but business is so good that investors aren't selling out of APD like they are other stocks. SoFi Technologies, ticker SOFI, is one of my favorite growth stocks right now and our buy-and-hold pick for the financial sector. And okay, before I get all kinds of comments on how SoFi is a terrible stock because it's down over the last year, Nation, you cannot judge the future of a stock by looking at its past. It's like forever swearing off Apple products because you bought the iPod socks back in 2004. Hey, I wasn't the one telling you to buy growth stocks like SoFi last year when they hit ludicrous speed levels of valuation. That was some other Yahoo on YouTube or some 15-year-old on TikTok. With the stock down 70%, though, it's still the same growth company, but now that valuation makes this a good investment. Now, SoFi started as an online loan refinance platform, but has evolved into a full-service fintech wallet, and I believe is one of the best positioned for the future of digital banking. Where other fintech platforms like PayPal and Upstart are still trying to bring on their products and services, SoFi already has a lead in everything finance, from insurance to credit, investing, and banking. And a big part of this was the company's approval for a banking charter, which it got through its acquisition of Golden Pacific Bancorp last year. Because most other fintech companies don't have that bank charter, they can't offer services like checking and savings, and they don't have access to those low rates like a traditional bank. This really does put SoFi way ahead of the competition, and the company is going to be leveraging that for growth. The company reported 87% growth in new members last quarter to almost 3.5 million, and while the percentage increase is slowing, that is still amazing growth at that scale. To put that into perspective, the company's closest competitor, Ally Financial, grew its customer base by just 11.7% last year. SoFi grew revenue by 63% last year to over $1 billion, and more importantly here, became earnings positive on an EBITDA basis with $30 million in earnings before interest, taxes, and depreciation. Now, management has guided to 55% growth in revenue this year to nearly $1.6 billion and a six-fold increase in adjusted earnings. But what's really powerful here is just take a look at that change in EBITDA margin from 3% in 2021 to a projected 11% this year. And that margin is the profitability, the amount of earnings as a percentage of sales, so how efficient management is at converting those sales into profits. Now, I just started buying the shares this year myself after that massive sell-off from the IPO last year. And this stock is now trading for just 6 times on a price-to-sales basis for a company growing revenue by 50% plus a year. of all the stocks on this list, I think SoFi is one of my top three for long-term growth. It was a tough choice to pick just one stock for the tech sector, but I'm gonna have to go with size and scope here in Alphabet, ticker GOOG. Alphabet dominates the online search market with 80% market share, and that extends to its network effect across YouTube and its Android ecosystem of apps. Add in the growth from cloud services, and it's hard denying the company's leadership in tech. Now, even on some weakness in advertising, revenue grew 23% last quarter and is expected 15% higher this year and next. Now that's 15% revenue growth on a scale of $300 billion a year. It's the profitability that's really impressive, though. The operating margin has grown to 30% from just 22% in 2019, producing $82 billion in operating profits every year. And now with Google, besides just that profitability and the growth, I think there's a lot of hidden value here. Buying the shares, you're basically paying for that main search, cloud, and YouTube business, but I don't think the market has priced in anything from the ride-hailing services or a lot of the special projects Google owns. So you're getting all those other businesses like Waymo, DeepMind, and Calico, its life extension project. These are all like lottery ticket bonuses on top of the return of the search and YouTube. Your shares are down 25% in the sell-off this year, and this is another one with that multi-year low in valuation. Google is now at 5.7 times on a price-to-sales basis, a 15% discount to its 5-year average, and an even bigger discount on that price-to-earnings basis. This is a company generating $69 billion in free cash flow a year with a massive share repurchase program and $20 billion in cash. Now, only being able to highlight one stock in each sector, obviously I had to leave a lot of great stocks off this list, but I want to get your opinion on this. Which stocks are you buying for that long-term buy and hold strategy? So scroll down and let me know in the comments, which stocks do you think I should have included? Consumer discretionary was another tough sector to pick just one stock, but I've got to go with Amazon, ticker AMZN, for a lot of the same reasons as Google. Amazon dominates in its two core markets, with nearly 60% of the US e-commerce market, a number no other company even comes close to matching. Amazon also controls a third of the global market for cloud services, 50% more than its next largest competitor. And when you've got that kind of market control, it's an advantage the company can use across all its products and services. Revenue has doubled in the last 3 years to $470 billion and is expected to hit $613 billion next year. And now, just like with Google, I think the market is underestimating shares of Amazon. For a share of Amazon, you're basically paying for that valuation on the core e-commerce platform and its Amazon Cloud Services business, but you're also getting all the Alexa venture investments in AI, voice, and other tech innovations. And there's evidence that core valuation itself may be undervalued. Activist investor Dan Loeb made news February when he estimated $1 trillion in hidden value for the shares if you just value the two segments separately in a split of the company. That would make it a $2.5 billion company, or about double the current stock price. Now, I've always had trouble recommending Amazon because of that expensive valuation, but after this recent sell-off, it's now down to a place I've never seen it before. Shares trade for just 2.6 times on a price-to-sales basis, which is about half the 2020 valuation. And while the 58 times PE ratio still seems high, it's just a fifth of where the stock was trading at in 2017, and less than half of its 5-year average. So this one is actually a value stock territory. Now, energy was a tough sector because of that recent surge in prices, but I still like Chevron Corporation, ticker CVX, for that long-term investment. Our shares of CVX are up 72% in the last year, and stocks in the sector wide are up 63% on oil prices that have surged to $120 a barrel. And while I do believe oil will come back down to around $80 or $90 a barrel, there's one reason I think investors can still hold on to Chevron and a few others. This is a chart of the oil price needed to break even at the 8 largest producers, with the red dots that 2021 break-even price. You can see Chevron is among the lowest in the group, needing oil at just $50 a barrel to turn a profit. So even if the price of oil does come down, you've got companies like Chevron, RDS, and Total that are still making a lot of money, even as others like Exxon struggle with its profitability. Chevron is taking advantage of the higher prices now to increase its share repurchase program, expecting to buy back over $3.8 billion of its own stock in the first half of the year. That, combined with a 3.3% dividend yield, helps to support the case of the stock, even though it is trading a little expensive. Shares are trading for 1.9 times sales, or about 20% above that 5-year average, but again, cash flow and profitability is there to support the stock, and investor returns even if the price of the oil comes down. Now, Chevron is a solid dividend stock with a 3% yield, but it can't touch the 11 stocks I've recently highlighted in another video, the highest paying dividend stocks in each sector. So look for that link in the description below. Being an old Iowa boy, I had to go with Deere & Company, ticker DE, for our stock to buy in the industrial sector. Now, Deere books just over half of its revenue from agricultural production equipment, but also has some great diversification through construction and road building. Sales are up 18% in the last 3 years, but could be coming into a period of super normal growth on two factors. The average age of farm equipment is estimated around 17 to 20 years old, with aftermarket parts demand increasing. Ag producers are seeing higher cash flows this year on that jump in grain prices, and that alone sets us up for a renewal cycle in equipment. More importantly though, Deere is leading a revolution in autonomous tractor and farm equipment. Upgrading those old driver models to the new technology will drive a surge in profitability for those large operators and is well worth the cost of that new equipment. And shares aren't necessarily cheap here. Even though the stock was flat over the last year, it saw a big jump in the year prior and is now at 2.4 times on that price to sales basis. Still, revenue is expected to grow 18% this year and continue to post those double-digit growths, so the recent lag in returns could be a great opportunity. Healthcare is one of my favorite growth sectors and one of my favorite growth stocks as well. Teladoc Health, ticker TDOC. Now, this is another one I started buying in January after that massive crash from the stock price last year, and I know a lot of you are going to look at that stock chart and immediately write this one off. Even with the cost basis of $45 a share, I'm still down about 28% on 1,300 shares, but this is still the same growth company it was last year, and this stock easily gets to $150 a share in the next 3 years. Teladoc is a global leader in virtual healthcare with a provider network that covers 76 million US patients and a billion member data points from traditional telehealth to remote monitoring and next generation primary care. Now, obviously the last 2 years were huge here, like 5 years of growth in one, but the company was already growing at a solid rate. Membership growth has grown 33% annually since 2018, and the company booked nearly 15 million patient visits a year. Revenue doubled during the pandemic, and 80% of that is from recurring services, so I like that stability even if the growth in telehealth slows over the pandemic pace. Now, longer term, telehealth and virtual care is the future, but I think the data is really that undiscovered value here. Processing all those patient data points for analysis and research. And where just last year, shares of Teladoc were the poster child for those expensive growth stocks, the sell-off has taken this one into really attractive territory. Through increased monetization and modest member growth each year, management has a 3-year target for 25 to 30% annual revenue growth. That takes it to just over $4 billion in revenue by 2024 on estimates for $2.6 billion this year. Shares of Teladoc are now trading for just 2.5 times on that price-to-sales basis. Now, this is a stock that at one point traded for 17 times its sales and well over $300 a share, now under $35 each and still growing by 30% a year. Even on a very conservative price multiple of just 5 times its 2024 sales target of $4 billion, that is a $20 billion company for 112% return and $146 per share price. For our forever stock in the utilities sector, I'm going with Energy Energy, ticker NRG, and its 3% dividend yield. And the company is one of the largest energy producers in the US with over 6 million residential customers and 14 gigawatts of generation across electricity and natural gas. Now, even though it's an independent provider, it still operates in that protected, regulated market of electric and natural gas, so cash flows are extremely consistent here. That's helped management commit to a constant dividend growth while still being able to grow the company and the share price as well. And the recent acquisition of Direct Energy is expected to produce over $300 million in savings and drive part of its strategic growth initiative, growing that dual fuel business and streamlining production. That should result in even stronger cash flows and higher dividends. Now, that acquisition has already come through in higher revenue, doubling sales in the most recent quarter, and the shares are trading for just 0.42 times on a price-to-sales basis. This is a strong value stock with a stable dividend and a long-term growth. Don't forget to get your free report with the link below or click on the video to the right for the 11 highest dividend paying stocks in each sector, the 11 best dividend payers in the market. Don't forget to join the Let's Talk Money community by tapping that subscribe button and clicking the bell notification.